Good morning, and I would like to welcome everyone to this, the 14th meeting of the Standards, Procedure and Public Appointments Committee in 2022. Agenda item one is a decision on taking business in private, and that is that we agree to take item seven in private. Item seven is consideration of correspondence in relation to the future parliamentary procedure and practices inquiry. Are the members happy to take that in private? I'm grateful. And the second item is to welcome the return of Alexander Stewart MSP and his opportunity to declare any relevant interests that he would like to put on the record. Do you have any interests to declare, Alexander?
I don't have any, convener, and I'm delighted to once again return to the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee and look forward to working with you all.
Excellent. It is good to welcome back our boomerang member over a number of sessions, but it also gives me the opportunity to say that Alexander is replacing Tess White MSP, and I would like both formally to put on the record here our thanks to Tess for her extensive work on the committee over a relatively short period of time, and hope the committee would be in agreement for me to write to her to thank her for her time of service. I'm grateful. And the next item is a cross-party group. I'd like to welcome Katie Clark, MSP, who is the potential convener of the proposed cross-party group on Europe. Good morning, Katie. Would you like to explain the purposes of the group?
Thank you, convener. And first of all, can I apologise that I wasn't in attendance at the last meeting? I had transportation issues on the day, and I'm sorry for the inconvenience that that would have caused. But I'm delighted to be here today and to hopefully be able to persuade you that a cross-party group on Europe should be established. I believe that there is interest from members for such a group, and I think there is very not much the space for the kind of discussions that a cross-party group in Europe would take part in. Obviously, there would be occasions where there would be overlap with other cross-party groups. I suspect on occasions we may wish to have joint events, but many of the issues that I think a cross-party group on Europe in relation to the post-Brexit issues, in relation to our relationship with the European Union specifically, but Europe more generally, I believe, will not be covered by other cross-party groups. So I think there is the appetite for the group, and I believe that you know that there are many discussions that can take place there that would be of use and would not necessarily be taking place in other cross-party groups.
Thank you very much for that, and your apology is noted. Does any member of the committee have any questions? Alexander, can I come to you?
Thank you very much, Katie, for that. There's no doubt, as you've indicated in your submission, that there is potentially need for this, but you've also indicated that there are a number of other groups that already have been in place, and some of these groups have been there for some time, and they have created a niche market, whether it is in Germany or the universities or Poland or whatever. So I would ask, what level do you think you would have cooperation and support from these other cross-party groups? Because they may do things that you want to try and do in a larger area, but also the experience and the knowledge that they have may be of great use to you as a new group trying to establish across Europe itself.
Yes, and I think that's an extremely helpful question. I suppose partly it would depend on the appetite of the cross-party groups in question, but in terms of those who are currently involved in the work to establish this particular cross-party group, there's very much a willingness and a desire to work with existing cross-party groups. So, you know, to use the example that's already been given in terms of education and Erasmus, which is a massive issue at the moment, already some of the organisations that are involved in the cross-party group are disproportionately in the education sector. So I think that is a big issue in the early days, and it's very much an issue that we need to work with other cross-party groups on. So I think we would be very sensitive, or attempt to be very sensitive, to the work that's already taking place and attempt to work collaboratively. And if another cross-party group was already leading on an issue, then that obviously would be an argument that perhaps we should focus on another area. I think, for example, you know, the post-Brexit issues are potentially massive. And there's no doubt going to be a continuing debate about that. You know, for example, some people are arguing that it should be a softer form of Brexit, that we should rejoin the single market. Those kind of debates may become big debates over the coming period of time or may not. And I would very much hope there'd be a range of views within the cross-party group that, I don't think we should take, there should be a presumption that there would be one view. I suspect that we would want to have a range of views and to have that discussion. That is the nature of a cross-party group. And I would hope that would be the way that the group would develop.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Edward. Anyone else? Can I just pursue that point slightly with you, Katie, with regard to the other more country-specific, I'm thinking, CPGs? The intention, this is my question, is the intention for this group to offer a more pan-European view of problems that could perhaps feed in and assist those other CPGs rather than a sort of separate standalone. You mentioned Erasmus, which in its sense lends itself to a pan-European view. So rather than being the interfering expert in a country, what you intend to offer is a sort of room for European expertise to come together and feed into that work.
Yeah, I think that's correct. I mean, for example, if we look at the cross-party group in Poland that's quite active and has been quite active on issues in relation to the rights of EU citizens, then clearly that's an issue for a number of cross-party groups, in particular the specific, you know, European country groups. But if you like, hopefully the CPG on Europe might bring some of that together. I don't think it would undermine any of the work that's being done by any specific group. And, for example, the cross-party group on Poland will be very focused on the Polish community, whereas the potential cross-party group in Europe would be looking at as you say, on a pan-European basis. But the issues are basically the same or very, very similar in relation to every country. So, you know, there's obviously a number of countries where there's no cross-party group, and it may be that, the cross-party group in Europe may pick up some of that in terms of, you know, issues for specific communities that aren't covered by any of the standalone European country groups. But I suspect, like most cross-party groups, we will react to events and, you know, it will be the issues where we think there's a desire and an appetite for a debate in Parliament that will dictate the agenda. But, you know, from my perspective, and I think from all of the members listed and that have attended meetings so far, there would be very much a wish to work collaboratively and try to look at ways of doing that. And of course, the problem sometimes is if we don't know somebody else is already doing work, and that's our job to try and make sure that we make the attempts to find out exactly what's happening and to make sure that we're not, you know, undermining the work of any other group.
It's very helpful.
Which is already in existence.
That's very helpful. Thank you. Colette, I think you have a question.
Yeah, thanks, Katie. And hi, Katie. I just note from the membership as well on the group, or the proposed group, that there's no representation there from the Conservative Party. Was there a particular reason for that?
No, there isn't a particular reason at all. I think we would welcome representation. And as I say, that was one of the reasons that I said I think it's important that there's an understanding and a recognition that, you know, there might be a range of views within the group. I suspect there probably already is a range of views on many issues within the list of members that we have before us today. But, you know, it could be that range might expand. I think it's about grappling with the issues and having that discussion in a way that perhaps is less heated than might take place in the chamber, where, you know, there's a sort of genuine exchange of ideas and information. And hopefully this could be a forum where that could happen. I think also some members of the group are very keen that we use it as a vehicle to find out more about what's happening in the European Union and to foster, if you like, direct relations in terms of, you know, other European politicians and, you know, parts of the various European structures, not just the European Union, to find out more about what they're doing, perhaps with guest speakers and other events that would, you know, bring, if you like, information and a better understanding, perhaps, of what's happening in other parts of Europe. So, as I say, I think, you know, it will partly be determined by you know, what members of the group want to do and events. I think the reason for the group would really be on a pan-European basis rather than on any specific issue. And if, for example, there was already a lot of work happening on a particular area in the Parliament or in another cross-party group, that would be an argument for us perhaps to focus on something different. And, you know, that I would imagine that was the, would be the way that it would develop. But as I say, I think we may well have some joint events hopefully they will be successful.
Thank you.
And it is right to say that the number of MSPs who have indicated an intention to join meets the cross-party requirement for a cross-party group in any event. If there are no further questions, I'll refrain from asking the primary school teacher question of, so how are you defining Europe? And maybe review that in due course. The committee will consider whether to accord recognition in the next session at agenda item 3, and the clerks will notify you of that outcome in due course. But I thank you for attending today.
I'm very grateful. Thank you very much. Thank you.
And indeed, agenda item 4 is for the committee to consider whether to accord recognition to the proposed cross-party group on Europe. Do members have any comments before I formally put the question? Sue. Sorry, can I just, before Sue, because I am appalled at myself for this, but Edward Mountain has extended his apologies today because he has other parliamentary duties that are taking up this time. And so can I welcome you today, Sue, as his substitute? My apologies for not doing that before greeting Alexander's arrival.
That's OK. I'm almost like a permanent member. It feels like that anyway. I suppose my serious concern is with overlap and and some of the content that was mentioned, you know, with I know is forthcoming toward, for example, the Erasmus Plus, what that might be, and I'm just concerned of the actual legitimate need for it, given that there's other cross-party groups where it was mentioned that there will be overlap and the themes are the same. So I'm sorry, I've got some real concerns about this one.
Thank you for that. Any other comments, Bob?
Thank you, convener. I think it's reasonable for Sue to mention the real possibility of overlap, but I was listening to the exchange with Ms Clark and members, and what I got from it was a more strategic, thematic approach could be taken with a cross-party group in Europe as opposed to individual country cross-party groups. And I think it's important that the cross-party group in Europe is aware of that. And I think they are. That's what I got from the exchange, and there could be a benefit to the Parliament in relation to that. And of course, I'd be concerned if they sought to duplicate or overlap the work of specific discrete cross-party groups for individual countries. But there seems to be a kind of strategic fit of a more kind of pan-European. Was your line of questioning, Convener, in relation to that? So I think it's right to raise those concerns from Sue Webber, but by and large, I think on balance, it would be the right thing to do to approve this cross-party group.
Alexander.
Thank you, convener. I acknowledge the fact that there will be overlap, but I don't think that precludes the group from progressing, because, as I say, I think it will find its way and it will find its opportunity. And I think depending on the role that they see themselves doing, and yes, the overlap can happen, but at the same time, they may wish to then take a bigger view because the other ones are country-specific. So, you know, if there's an issue in Germany, there's an issue in Poland or whatever, if they want to then try and take it further and look at areas in Nordic or areas in the south of Europe, then there may be opportunities for them to feature. And by bringing in some of the experts within some of that, I think there's a role. There's also the role of the EU itself in the role. I mean, when the Culture Committee and others from here continually meet and have discussions with the Commission and the involvement that takes place, also the Consul Generals, etc., there's a much stronger link with all of that. So I am sympathetic to the view that there may well be the opportunity for a group of this nature to get some kind of support mechanism. As you say, the membership is quite wide and varied And I've no doubt that if it does come to pass, that there may be a Conservative member who wishes to participate in the process. So I am certainly more sympathetic towards the role, and I can see, but I think as long as the definitions are quite strict as to what they would do and how they would manage that, I see that there is an opportunity for it.
That's helpful. Any other comments? My only comment in respect to that is it is not for the place of this committee to become the arbiter or referee between CPGs. But I have to say, I think I share your view, Bob, that I was reassured by Katie Clark's assurances of the intention to find out and work collegiately with other CPG groups. And I was also taken by the fact that there are countries within Europe, however you define it, that don't have a specific CPG group. And indeed, as you said, Alexander, there is the question of the EU as well. So are we content to grant recognition to this proposed CPG? Yes? Okay. Absolutely respect that. Absolutely respect that position, Sue, and the record will show that. I'm grateful for that. And I'm presume the clerks will pass the message on to the now approved CPG. It is now my intention to move the... Oh, Bob.
Apologies, and this is the most appropriate place to put this on the record, but there has been a pattern where cross-party groups just come through, it's almost like a conveyor belt through the committee, and they get agreed. I think it's pretty healthy for this committee for there to be a degree of challenge and discussion in relation to the approval otherwise across party groups. I think I should put that on the record as well, because I've sat in this committee long enough now to know that it does just seem like a procession of cross party groups, and there's always been concern over a proliferation of them within the parliament. So whilst myself and Sue may have had a different perspective in relation to this, I think it does the committee a service to be a bit more robust and challenging the fit of cross party groups more generally in the parliament. I just wanted to put that on the record.
That's very helpful, Bob, and it is right to say that within our work stream, one of the intentions from the very start was to review the number of CPGs and those processes at a time when we were aware of how it was panning out in this session. And I think we are heading to that stage, certainly probably soon after recess. But it is also right, and you know, I'm grateful to you to put this on the record, that CPGs by this committee, I've never known them be nodded through without some investigation. And, you know, it is absolutely within the rights, as Sue's exercised this morning, to express concern where it is, and it becomes a committee decision. So I don't know whether that's a warning to potential CPG conveners out there or not, but it's not a foregone conclusion that one person's good idea, even with cross-party support, will get through without proper and judicious investigation of the intention. So thank you for that. So with that, I will move this committee into private.